Hello and welcome to the 78th episode of Growing Up Geek, the weekly podcast for geek entertainment and nostalgia. My name is Brad, and I'm joined by a man who has not yet uploaded his New Moon reaction video, my brother Rob.
Oh my god. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing good. Oh my god.
Just for the audience, I just showed Rob
these
New Moon reaction videos. For those who don't know, New Moon is the sequel to Twilight.
For those who don't know, Twilight is a book full of vampires that are sexy.
Supposedly. And you have all these reaction videos to the trailer, which was shown during the MTV Movie Awards. And these girls are just... It looks like they're seeing, like, Lost finale revelation level surprises. Like, the surprise in their faces and the shock is, like, apocalyptic. Like, I don't know how to describe it.
They scream and they, like, wave their hands. They're just, like...
Well, the one girl's choked up. Like, as soon as the trailer starts, she, like, covers her mouth. And if people want to see this user on YouTube is Sweet Love to You. The level of energy is just so amazing. And, you know, I could take this in a dark place and say, haha, Twilight fans, but I actually want to be, let's be adults about this for a second, because while I am getting old and I'm definitely out of it as far as Twilight and High School Musical and all that, the reactions in this video are kind of like my reactions to, like, Star Wars trailer episode one, you know, or Watchmen,
right,
or something like that. Like, I react, not crying, but I react very excitedly to things like that. And I had to see what it is these girls were excited about. So I went and watched the New Moon trailer. And there's a particular part, you noticed this, where they both are like, like blown away.
Yeah.
And I was scrubbed to that part of the trailer. And it's a guy standing up with his shirt off.
Really?
Like that. Yeah, I know.
I thought somebody died in front of them.
Right. The reaction is like that level. And all I can think is they must have read the book. Because Amber and I watched this during the movie awards and we had no reaction. Like it just, you know, swept over us. And there's a wolf at the end, like a morph. But it's really crappy, like CG morph from a guy into a wolf. And the wolf is like dog-like. It's very lame. They explode at the end when that happens. So I'm thinking these are probably just, you know, they've read the book and they kind of add extra weight to it, maybe.
Yeah, it's like us seeing Coruscant or something like that. We're just like, oh my goodness, this thing we've heard a lot about but haven't actually seen. And I agree. Like, watching it, I've reacted like that to things worse, you know. I've always mentioned on the show before how I had to run swiftly to the bathroom upon opening up my Sega CD for Christmas.
Yeah.
And most people probably don't even know if Sega CD, like, what that is.
Well, that's the thing. I'm sure, you know, this kind of puts you in the framework of people who have looked down on you and said, why are you so excited about that? In fact, once in high school, I was talking about DJ in Street Fighter with a friend of mine because he's my favorite character. And some girl whirled around in her chair and said, "Who's DJ?" And I figure, oh god, she thinks I'm talking about like some boyfriend of someone else. And I said, "Well, he's a character in Street Fighter." And she went, "Ah, video games are so irrelevant to life."
Then you point at her, you're like, "You're irrelevant," and then you'd run into the bathroom and cry
and wet myself
while reading your comics.
Exactly. Yeah. But no, I just wanted to say, like, that level of excitement, I've definitely felt it. So
and it was better for me because I actually have no idea what's going on in the trailer.
Yeah, so it almost is better, like, that way.
I'm listening to the lines and it's just like, "I made you a birthday cake."
and they're like crying. Yeah,
it's like, and they're like, "Oh my gosh!" Like, I would just be reacting to that information. There's a birthday cake. There's a paper cut. There's something like that. They're all thinking about, okay, where that leads and what does that mean in significance to everything else.
The same way that we did with Watchmen, because when Ozymandias spread his arms in that trailer, we didn't geek out because of how cool he looked. I'm sure a lot of people were like, okay, that's a lame looking costume, but we knew who that was and all the weight that goes with that. So I can relate to these girls, even though that is a hilarious video clip.
Proof that girls can be geeks too.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And so, on that note, let's go ahead and move into geek news. Rob, what was your favorite news story this week?
Well, my favorite news story this week, or actually interesting information emerging from Microsoft.
Yes, I've heard of them.
Or not emerging, because executive Steve Ballmer,
right,
who, give it up for him,
Yes. In joke. Well, not so in. I guess the internet.
Woo!
But go ahead.
Yeah. Well, he apparently was at an executive meeting thing, very posh, and was talking about, you know, Xbox and things like that and how it's doing great. And then he's like, and in 2010, you can expect to see, like, a newly made Xbox with all new natural motion controls.
Yes, to which everyone's head exploded.
Right. And they were like, wait, is he announcing the new Xbox and that Natal is going to be the controller for a brand new console altogether? But apparently no. Major Nelson and Ballmer have clarified. You know, they're like, I misspoke. I didn't mean what I said.
Sorry.
I guess he was just saying Natal is basically due out by 2010.
Yeah, and that was something I think that they had announced during E3, was this is an upcoming technology to be used in the current generation. But one news story I read actually showed Natal up close, and it kind of like my mind suddenly broke because I looked and I saw the green light on it, and I'm like, holy crap, Natal is the system. You know, but that it was like that ended up being too much hype. But
yeah,
I know it got you thinking about things.
Well, yeah, I mean, they could at least use like a repackaged Xbox, like a tinier one.
Oh, sure, yeah.
By now, that technology has to be, you know, diminishable.
Right.
Is it time for a new Xbox? I mean, it's been out for almost 5 years.
Yeah. Like, there's no hard and fast rule, because some consoles have lasted, like, you know, like the PS2 is still going on. I think 3 or 4 has been the typical number, but, like, the economy, I think, has changed things where Sony and Microsoft are in no hurry to rush out a brand new system, although I'm sure they're developing it.
I'm kind of worried, though, because now is Natal going to be an add-on to the Xbox 360? And if so, is it really going to get all that much support?
Yeah, well, I suddenly got really worried, too, because like it could go one of two ways. So let's look at this. It could either be an add-on, which notoriously add-ons fail. You know, like, it splits the user base. Not as many people have it, so fewer developers. You know, like iToy.
Yeah.
You know, iToy has, like, 3 games, and that's it, you know? But if you go the other route and you build it into the system, does that mean that, like, every game I'm going to be, like, jiggling in front of my television? And if so, I don't think I can handle that. I'm not suited for manual labor, you know? It's like, a lot of people have been saying, you know, I just want to sit down at the end of a hard day and play my game with the controller. You know, I just don't want to be physical all the time. It's a gimmick, but I don't know. What do you think? You're a Wii owner. I mean, do you get ticked off having to use the controller like that? Or do you like...
Not at all. It still kind of makes Wii games unique in a way. And we're going to get into that later in the show. But I'm actually excited about Natal as far as like also a... passive information. I mean, we've already discussed this whole thing.
Right, sure. But, like, if they build it into the system, do you think, like, it could withstand being the only controller? I mean, they would still have to have a controller.
No. You have to have something that you're pushing buttons and things like that. That's
so then you're splitting the base of even the built-in Natal system, like, because you've got half controller games and half Natal games. I don't know. It doesn't feel compatible with the future.
I think it'd be an excellent input device. You know, even if it's sitting there and doing nothing but, you know, feeding the color of your shirt into the game. You know, that works for me. Or like if you're talking to guys online, it captures your facial expressions, which of course are deadpan.
Right.
But
this will either be one of those things where you look back and it's like everyone who believed in it was genius, and everyone who doubted it was like, oh my god, you couldn't see that coming. You know.
Yeah.
Or it's going to be like Virtual Boy, you know?
Right. Well, yeah. So that's that. Brad, what was your favorite news story of the week?
They announced Longbox Digital Comics Service, which I got very excited about. And this announcement happened on Sunday at the Heroes Con. I guess it's a comic convention.
Okay.
This is going to be software for Mac, PC, and Linux that essentially will be the iTunes of comic books. And this is something that you know, you and I, we read comics, and it's like it's always the issue of like how do you get your comics. You know, sometimes I'll go to the library, or like, you know, there's not that many comic book stores, and like online takes a while to, you know, ship them. And it's like, can't they just do digital? Like, you know, music has gone that way and movies are going that way with Netflix and stuff. And I know like Marvel has a service where they let you see some of their comics digitally. But, like, DC has just taken, like, a very la-la-la-la-la, it's not happening, you know, and, like, head in the sand. So this is a this may not be the answer, but this is a answer. And the cool thing is that it also reads .cbr and .cbz files, which are the files of illegally downloaded comic books as well.
Uh-huh.
And so, you know, with a kind of a wink, they're saying, like, if you already read them, you're a click away from getting legal issues. And so far, they just have, like, Top Cow and, like, Boom Comics, I think. So just some small companies. But they're going to be 99 cents per issue. At least that's the suggested price. I like this idea very much. For me, the deal breaker is going to be the interface, because I've used Marvel's. I don't know. Have you tinkered around with Marvel's?
No.
Okay. Marvel's is kind of odd because it does this thing that's like a zoomed view, but it dances around the page. And I think panel by panel is the perfect way to go. And like on the iPhone, it works very well. You just flick from panel to panel. I always feel bad for these comic illustrators who, you know, you don't savor their work. You just sort of blast over the page with your eyes. This way you can like savor each panel.
They should at least provide an option. Be like, do you want to view it page for page or panel for panel?
Yeah,
you know, like,
yeah.
Obviously, you know, it's a niche audience, you know, comic book readers, but Audible has kept audiobooks going. This could be something that really, like, people who like artwork and are visually stimulated, you know, have kind of been ignored by this whole internet, you know, music revolution. So, yeah, I think that's cool. That's cool information there, you know?
The guy even said that he's hoping that he could get this on Xbox 360. And he actually said, I don't know what he meant, but he said, I've used my 360 controller and my big screen TV to read digital comics, and let me tell you, it was awesome, you know? And I believe that, like, kicking back,
yeah,
and, you know, just flipping through panel at a time, that could be a really great. I know Watchmen did that DVD, which was really fun. So anyway, this is due out in September or October, and here's hoping.
It's kind of a weird name, though. Longbox? I don't think it's going to capture the general audience very well.
No.
But anyway, that's not who it's meant for.
Yeah.
All right.
Just one last thing. If one day this syncs up with like a future version of the Kindle, you know, where there's like a color Kindle that you have all your comics on one device.
Oh, wow.
That'd be super sweet. Just
super
saying.
Super sweet, yeah.
Okay, so that is the news, geeky news for this week. Now let's move on to our main topic of discussion, which is going to be a video game called Ghostbusters.
All right.
Just a quick overview here. You played the Wii version.
Yep.
And I played the 360 version. So we're going to kind of go back and forth here. This was one of your most anticipated games of 2009. It is a third-person action game and kind of unprecedented as movie games go, because you've got almost all of the voice actors from the film, and it's written by Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis.
Mm-hmm.
You play as a new recruit to the Ghostbusters, and I'll just take it to you from there. So you played the Wii version.
Yeah.
Let's start with where the games are similar. Let's start with the story.
Well, it's a little campy just in terms of the general overall plot.
Uh-huh.
But the question of could you sit back and watch it the same way you would one of the Ghostbusters movies, and the answer is, you know, more or less no.
Right.
Yeah, a lot of it is kind of more or less, you know, excuses to have encounters with staples of the franchise. That,
yeah, they have the Gray Lady, you know, the librarian. In fact, when you go to the library, they have the exact shot from the first film. So if it was a film, people would tear them a new one, because they're essentially they're reusing a lot. However, I do have to say that Dan Aykroyd has talked about this idea of Ghostbusters Go to Hell, where Manhattan is sort of like in an alternate dimension, and it's like Manhelton. And some of that is in this game, and I thought that was really cool to see that, like the alternate dimension version of this world.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, playing as a rookie, he's mentioned that that would be a big part of the next film. So when the new ideas cropped up, I thought it worked pretty well.
Yeah, definitely. But overall, like, yeah, the plot of this game leaves a little to lacking, but the dialogue is still very good.
Yeah.
The characters are you know, interesting, and to hear the voices of the original Ghostbusters coming out, I mean, you gotta love it.
Yeah, and I thought some of the jokes were kind of clunkers, but there's some good stuff here. It's almost refreshing, because there's so many of these, you know, I'm gonna go this way, you know, kind of games that we've, you know, with Bionic Commando we made fun of. And here's Bill Murray, although he's probably the weakest of the four, but, you know, Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis delivering pretty witty lines, pretty good stuff.
Bill Murray's character still really doesn't take his job seriously, haphazard. Like, even though they're working with this incredibly, like, supernatural force, like, he's just so mild-mannered and just like, all right, gotta get some coffee now. You know, like,
it's kind of like Reaper, you know, which I'd recommend if you haven't seen that. But I love that combination, you know, people that are unfazed. Okay, so let's move on to another key difference between these two, which is the graphics.
Yeah. The Wii graphics are very cartoony, actually, in comparison to the 360's graphics.
Right.
You have the concept of playing the movie versus the concept of playing the cartoon, or like the emerging franchise after the movie.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. And did you think it looked a lot like the cartoon?
It did. I mean, well, obviously, Egon doesn't have his blonde hair.
Right, sure.
Which I wish he kind of did, but that's just me.
Yeah.
They obviously optimized it for the Wii, and I thought this decision was just inspired, you know, like, let's make it a cartoon version, you know, not even try to be the other thing.
So it didn't serve as a barrier, like, it didn't make it seem, like, too cartoony to get the humor and everything?
Well, if anything, it might be too cartoony to get the scary aspect.
Yeah, so I guess the ghosts look kind of cartoony, too.
Yeah, the ghosts are cartoony, Stay Puft is kind of blocky, you know, things like that.
Yeah, okay. The 360 version, like you mentioned Gears of War, it's detailed like that. And it's pretty cool to think that today's technology can really make the Ghostbusters look like themselves. You know, mostly everybody looks pretty darn close. If you squint, you'd kind of think you're watching the movie, especially during like the rendered cutscenes.
Yeah.
The proton pack on your back is, you know, you see everything on it. The environments are really textured well. It's all pretty good. The only problem is that it's occasionally got jittery frame rate issues, and when you turn and move and the Ghostbusters start moving and stuff, there's a little bit of like a stiff animation to it. And maybe it's because they look so good that it kind of breaks the reality of it, like Uncanny Valley style, where it's like, okay, you bump up against a piece of geometry or something and you're kind of like, like you just don't move as smoothly as like Gears of War. So let's move on from the look to the actual gameplay, which I'm curious to see how the Wii handles it because of the Wiimote. I would think like busting ghosts with the Wiimote would be awesome.
Yeah, it actually pretty much is.
Oh, awesome. That sucks. Well, that's the worst review ever. Yeah. Okay, yeah, cool. Yeah, tell us why. Why is it awesome?
Well, you're going to point it at him, and you're going to pull the trigger to shoot, and then you're going to kill him with it. You know, like, you wear him down with the photon blast.
Right.
So you'll get an arrow that points in a certain direction. You swing the remote that way, and then the ghost swings into the wall. Then also, to throw the trap, you use the other hand, pull the Z trigger down, and you throw your hand forward, and you release it throw it forward. So it literally throws it to the ground. So it's a very visceral feeling of like, I am capturing a ghost using these techniques.
That's awesome. It's the same. That's the same premise as the 360 in terms of wearing the ghost down and then dragging them into the trap. But I actually had a lot of... It's quite difficult to wrangle them into the trap. You know, using the analog stick, you're kind of like, you know, they're real squirrely. How did it feel with the Wiimote?
Oh, very easy. I mean, I would just drag him over using the Wiimote.
Like. Oh, okay. Yeah, I had a lot of difficulty lining the ghosts up with the trap.
Yeah.
The beam is very narrow on the trap, and to find the beam, I was like, come on, where is it?
You know?
A little bit difficult. But when you get it, and they're getting sucked down, and they're, you know, screaming, it's like you really feel like you're working for it, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And I like sort of the puzzle aspects. Like, they have that with these batteries that you have to charge and then plug into a wall and then stuff like that. So the pack really has a sort of, you know, physics-bending aspect to it, which I feel like with the Wiimote really lends itself well because you're using it to lift things and move things and drop things, so...
Yeah, it sounds like it might even be a little easier on the Wii, which would be good for me.
Yeah, well, if it was anything like playing Resident Evil 4 on the Wii versus on PlayStation 2, yeah, definitely is.
I think you were mentioning how the pack, like, overheats.
Yeah.
That's sort of like, to me, like the active reload from Gears of War. It happens quite often, and that's where I would give this a downside in terms of this game, is it goes through the motions of like other third-person games. Like, there's a roadie run where, you know, it's sort of like the Marcus Fenix thing where you duck and you run. And then there's like this really weird thing where you get knocked down when you're hit and you go ragdoll and your teammates have to revive you. It's like all those Gears of War things.
Now, on the Wii, they don't do the ragdoll. What you do is you get slimed. and you just hunch over full of slime, and they come and they unslime you.
Okay, that actually sounds better, because the whole ragdoll thing, it got annoying, and that's what I mean is, it does what these other games do, but it doesn't pull them off quite as enjoyably, you know? It's like a little stiffer, like the roadie run, it's kind of like crappy, you know, but sort of the same idea. What did you think of the EPK meter? There's this, you know, the device that they use in the movie that detects where the ghosts are coming from. Do you use that in the Wii version?
Yeah, but more or less, like, its purpose is to get bonus points. Maybe if this were, like, an adventure game, that would work, you know? Yeah. Like,
they don't explain it very well, because it feels like you need it constantly, like, to find the ghosts, but you really don't. And did you feel like me, kind of like the game might have been better in first person?
You know what, actually, you don't go into first person in the Wii version.
Oh, okay, you know, okay.
I was noticing that difference, actually, watching the videos of the 360. Mm-hmm. Is that, yeah, you just pull it out, and maybe because with the Wiimote, first person doesn't work as well, it's better to have a little distance and use a cursor, you know?
Well, it sounds like it plays just fine without the first person on the Wii.
Yeah,
I felt like the angle was a tad tight on your character in this, a little bit like Dead Space for me, but overall, advice. What would you say to people about the Wii version?
Well, I'd say it's a rental, definitely. Try it out. I don't think it's going to be a very long game, at least as far as I've gotten. And
yeah, I would agree. I'm at about 5 hours, and I've only got like a little bit left to go. Although, if you're a Ghostbusters fan, one thing we haven't covered here is the multiplayer. Unfortunately, we couldn't play against each other. But I have read that the multiplayer is really great because you have, you know, sort of the teamwork aspect and your friends can beam in and everything.
Mm.
That comes on someone else's authority, but the multiplayer is supposedly awesome. I would say this game is kind of a mixed experience for me. There are certainly better third-person shooters out there, like your Dead Spaces. I'm a Mercenaries man myself, Gears of War, obviously. But there are very few that actually try to recreate a movie so thoroughly. You know,
right?
Even if some of it falls flat, you get some new sweet, you know, discussions of boson darts and Mancala spheres or whatever. You know, this like full torso apparition. Dan Aykroyd believes in this stuff, and it's obvious. You know, like
yeah.
So that part was really enjoyable, but as a game, it's sort of ho hum. I'd also recommend renting it if you're interested, if you're a fan. Otherwise, you could probably find a better game.
Yeah, and about like which version to choose, I would say, you know, if you own one system or the other, obviously, I don't think you're going to be deprived of much by getting one or the other. It actually may be worth trying it on both. Like, it's actually uniquely different enough that it warrants maybe a rental and a re-rental. I'm actually considering renting the 360 version now.
Yeah, and I'm considering checking out the Wii. So that is Ghostbusters. Before we close out our show, we always like to get nostalgic and reminisce about growing up geek. Hence the name of the show. This week, in honor of the Wii and the Xbox 360, let's talk about console warfare. This is something I know that you and I were into, and we could probably do an entire show just on this, but let's try to give it as good of a go as we can. These days, I'm not as concerned about this stuff, but back then, dude, I was hardcore.
Absolutely, man. Our first use of the internet was to battle, you know, righteously N64 versus PlayStation, you know?
CDs versus cartridges. Like, that was really where I fought
out. Oh, yeah. I mean, we had binders full of stuff, you know, like the evidence, the whole, like, theories behind why people believe one way and how you can sway them the other way.
I poured through issues of Next Generation magazine, noting the scores for all of the PlayStation games and like comparing how many got like a 9 versus how many N64. Like, I was really into
that. You'd compare ad campaigns to show how Sony's was more mature and handled things properly compared to Nintendo's very immature sort of like butt crack humor and things like that. Like,
well, and speaking of butt cracks, all of that battling, as it were, actually won me something, a Jolt Cola jockstrap, which I never claimed, but Antagonist Online, that was a forum on AOL. It was basically, I won because of a post that I did, and the post was called In Defense of PlayStation or something like that. People could, I don't even know if this still exists. But yeah, it was just a very thorough, you know, evidence-based, you know, defense of PlayStation, and wow, that was, I had time on my hands. That's absolutely all I can say.
I think a big revelation for me came from Matt, where he sort of won an argument by not talking smack. You know, he wasn't like saying all the bad points, but basically he was just saying to the person, look, you're the consumer, you're in control. You don't have to have allegiance to any of these companies. If one comes out with a game that's better than the other, and that's the game you want, go with it. Who cares what the console is, or what the brand is, and if they were your favorite whenever you were a kid or something like that. Like, it all comes down to is what they're making now what you want, you know? So
yeah. Well, I know Matt now is very anti-console war. Like, if you bring up why one is better than another, which I will admit that I still do some of that, and it's only because I don't have unlimited money. You know, I have to pick when the next three come out. I have to make a selection and choose, and so I'll normally run down, again, rationally, who has what. But I know Matt has always said, you know, it's about the games.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's fine as long as you can afford all the systems, you know, because you will, you know, pay up for it.
Yeah, my rule of thumb has always kind of been, and if you can buy enough games where, like, basically the dollar value of the games you're buying equals the dollar value that you spent on that system. You know, I realize you're paying twice the money, but for my sake, as far as entertainment dollar goes, that's sort of breaking even. It's like you've gotten that much entertainment out of the system. So then it justifies it. Like, I got an HD DVD player, and I know that yes, was a huge war, you know, that just recently. But I don't care. Like, I don't mind that I have it, because I have all these movies that I can still watch in high definition on it.
Right.
And I feel like, you know what? I got my money's worth.
Yeah.
I think when it comes down to it, though, like PlayStation 3 being like $400, $500, I'm having trouble justifying buying that whenever it's like, well, what am I getting? Well, maybe Drake's Fortune.
Dude,
maybe
my list is growing. In fact, I could cite you off. Let's see here. I have a list called Sony Wish List.
So you're still keeping these lists.
I am apparently still doing this, and I'm using Google now, which is nice.
Right.
Their notebook feature. But I've got Uncharted 2, Last Guardian, Ratchet & Clank, Metal Gear Solid, Flower, Wipeout, MotorStorm, Infamous, Killzone, God of War. That's a pretty hefty list. Nobi Nobi Boy, Pixel Junk Eden. Those are exclusive PS titles. Just so anyone listening doesn't think I'm always dissing on Sony, dude, that stuff sounds great. But even with all those great games like that I would surely buy, that's a lot of cash. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just split between two consoles. So I think most people are in the boat that I am, where they have to make a decision. And in that case, like you were talking about earlier, it really helps to just be rational about it and not, you know, just sling mud or just bear some sort of allegiance, blind allegiance, just because you have to or whatever. I was a Sony fan, you know, for a long time. And when Microsoft did it better, or did it better for me, I will say, I went with them, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's just follow the best one for you. I mean, it obviously, you don't, and once you make your choice, you don't have to tell someone else that their stuff is stupid.
Yeah.
We used to get those videos from Nintendo in the mail, and just like, oh, it would anger us so much. The Donkey Kong Country one and the N64 one especially.
The Rumble Pack one was especially atrocious.
The Rumble Pack, where a Sony and Nintendo mascot basically, or guys playing them. The Sega guy was a big idiot, and the Sony guy was like a weaselly guy, and they kidnapped a guy from Nintendo, and they forced him to like sit in a chair, and it made your skin crawl. Just, you were embarrassed for Nintendo, you were embarrassed for everyone that acted in it. It was like,
YouTube that crap, see if you can find it.
YouTube that, and YouTube the Donkey Kong Country video with the guy who's, wow, surprisingly Wayne's World, like, now looking back on it. But at the end of that, they're like, not on Sega, not on, you know, and they're getting all...
It's not 32-bit, yeah.
Yeah, even the actor in the one, the Star Fox, the Rumble Pack one, he's like visibly like angry. He's like, ha-ha, there are three vehicles in Star Fox. And they're like, whoa, like they get their minds blown, apparently.
There's no way we have anything this good.
It's hard to watch. Okay, anyway, console warfare.
Good times.
There's no need for it. Yeah. Relax, kids. But yeah. Okay, so if you fought the console war or have any geeky memories you'd like to share with us, you can email us. Our website is growing-up-geek.com. And as always, you can follow Rob throughout the week on Twitter at twitter.com/GUGRob. I think that's going to do it for this week. Once again, my name is Brad.
Give it up for me!
And we'll see you next week.